So first, thanks Adriana for the invitation, and thanks Ruben and Dr. Coleman for the kind invitation to be here. And my talk will be focused on smoldering, who and when to treat. And here you can see, oh, sorry. This is a clinical case, and I would say that this is the common way in which you can suspect the diagnosis of smoldering myeloma. A 52 years old man, completely asymptomatic, in which in a routine analysis you can see serum total proteins elevated, 10.2, with normal albumin. Hemogram and biochemistry, completely normal. You proceed with the serum protein electrophoresis and bone marrow aspiration, and you can find an M spike of 3.2 grams per deciliter, as well as 12% of plasma cell bone marrow infiltration. Your first suspect will be a smoldering myeloma, but of course you have to do the differential diagnosis with other plasma cell disorders, like monoclonal gammopathy, in which the M component is inferior to 3 and the plasma cell bone marrow infiltration is inferior to 10% without any myeloma defining event. And also you have to do the differential diagnosis with myeloma, in which, as you know, myeloma defining event is always present. However, before doing the diagnosis of smoldering, I think that you have to be careful with the myeloma-related symptomatology, because there are some concomitant diseases, especially in elderly patients, that can mimic myeloma-related symptomatology. Anemia due to iron deficiency, or renal impairment due to diabetes or hypertension, or hypercalcemia due to hyperparathyroidism, and it's important to be careful that this symptomatology is due to the myeloma or due to concomitant disease to do the correct diagnosis of smoldering myeloma. The second important consideration is when you suspect smoldering myeloma diagnosis, you have to repeat at least the hemogram, biochemistry, and serum protein studies in approximately 2 or 3 months' time to confirm the M component remains stable, that there is not anemia, there is not renal impairment, there is not hypercalcemia. So you can confirm the diagnosis of smoldering, and you can proceed with the following evaluations. Are there any specific subgroup of patients with smoldering that can be treated? The answer is yes, and in fact, according to the update of the criteria for the definition of myeloma, I would say that a subgroup of previously called smoldering myeloma have to be treated. Those patients having any one or more of the biomarkers you can see in the slide, more than 60% of plasma cell bone marrow infiltration, serum free light chain ratio higher than 100, or 2 or more focal lesions in MRI. The rationale is because when one smoldering myeloma patient had serum free light chain ratio higher than 100, the risk of progression to myeloma was very high. I would say that the risk was imminent, and this was the reason why this patient should be called now myeloma. The second biomarker is the plasma cell bone marrow infiltration higher than 60%. For these patients, the median time to progression to myeloma was only 9 months, and again, this was the reason why this patient should be called now myeloma. And the third biomarker was the presence of 2 or more focal lesions in MRI, because again, the median time to progression was of approximately 1 year, and this patient should be called now myeloma. However, if you plan the question, how many patients, so this implies that if we review the recommended World Cup for smoldering myeloma at baseline, serum free light chain ratio, as well as bone marrow aspirate, and of course MRI should be done in order to ensure the diagnosis is myeloma or smoldering myeloma. However, if we plan the question how many new myeloma patients can be considered according to the new biomarkers? The answer is that few patients previously called smoldering are now considered myeloma. And according to the Swedish registry published by Sigmundur Christensen in New England Journal of Medicine, I would say that the incidence is of approximately 0.14 patients per 100,000 inhabitants a year. So many few patients. What is the next step? What happens with the other smoldering myeloma patients? You have probably seen many times this slide in which you can see as the risk of progression to myeloma for smoldering myeloma patients is not uniform. And we can identify the three different subgroups of patients. Patients at low risk, patients at intermediate risk, and patients at high risk, in which the risk is 10% per year, or in other words, approximately 50% of risk of progression at 2 years. So the next recommendation would be that each smoldering myeloma patient probably has to be stratified according to the risk of progression to myeloma. And is possible to do this? The answer is yes, and you can use the major risk model considering the M component and the plasma cell bone marrow infiltration. And you can see here three different subgroups of patients. Patients at high risk are those having more than 3 grams per deciliter of monoclonal component plus more than 10% of plasma cell bone marrow infiltration. Also, you can use the Spanish model in which we evaluated the plasma cell bone marrow compartment by flow cytometry, and when most plasma cells are aberrant, and in addition, the patient has immunoparesis, the risk of progression is also high, 50% at 2 years. We can also consider, for example, the Benz-Jones proteinuria in patients with a smoldering IgG or IgA. And when Benz-Jones proteinuria is present, the risk of progression to myeloma is also significantly higher. We can consider also the evolution pattern of the monoclonal component, and this was first described by the group of Dr. Blade in Barcelona, and you can see as when the M component was evolving over the time, the risk of progression was also significantly higher. And this parameter has been recently validated by the Mayo Clinic group. And the evolution pattern of the monoclonal component, together with the evolution pattern of the hemoglobin, when the hemoglobin decreased 0.5 grams per deciliter within the first year since the diagnosis, the risk of progression is also significantly higher. We can also evaluate cytogenetic abnormalities to identify a high-risk subgroup of smoldering myeloma patients. And if you want, it's also possible to do gene expression profiling. And the slide is not here, but gene expression profiling is able also to identify a gene signature for the identification of patients at high risk and another signature for the identification of patients at high risk. Novel imaging assessments can be also used in smoldering myeloma and when PET CT is positive, but only in the PET part without any lytic lesion in the CT part, the risk of progression to myeloma is also significantly higher, published by Elena Zamagni from Italy and also confirmed by the Mayo Clinic group. Here you can see different risk models for the evaluation of the risk of progression to myeloma for each specific patient with a smoldering. And I would say that the Mayo and the Spanish model have been so far validated in a clinical trial. And probably you know that Dr. Landreg published some years ago that there was not any concordance between the Mayo and the risk model because some patients considered at high risk according to the Spanish model were at low or intermediate risk according to the Mayo model. And what we don't know is what was really the outcome of these patients with disagreement about both models. And what we have done in our trial conducted in a smoldering myeloma patient was to apply the major risk model and also the Spanish risk model. And you can see as both are able to identify patients at high risk, and the median time to progression in the control arm was similar, and I would say identical, according to both Mayo and Spanish model. What is the next step? How to proceed once our smoldering myeloma patients are stratified according to the risk of progression? I would say that low risk and intermediate risk probably have to be followed just once per year for low risk, or probably every twice per year for intermediate risk patients. Ultra high risk has to be considered as a myeloma and be treated. And the problem or the question mark will be for high risk smoldering myeloma patients. How to proceed with the patients at low and intermediate risk? What is the correct follow-up? What is the optimal workup to do? And I would say that probably bone marrow aspirate is only required in case of progression to active disease. Skeletal survey, low-dose CT, or even PET CT would be probably recommendable for intermediate risk patients. And if one patient with a smoldering has only one focal lesion, probably it is recommended to repeat the MRI in approximately 6 months' time in order to confirm if the focal lesion is present or these focal lesions are expanded and there are more than one focal lesion. Concerning the high-risk smoldering myeloma patients, I would say that the Spanish myeloma group conducted this phase 3 randomized trial in just high-risk smoldering myeloma patients according to the Mayo on the Spanish model, and patients were randomized to receive early treatment with lenalidomide and dexamethasone versus no treatment. The primary endpoint was time to progression, and when we published the first time the results of this trial in 2013, the benefit was evident for the experimental arm, and now we have updated this series of patients, and the median follow-up is now of approximately 6 years, and you can see as the benefit is sustained for those patients receiving early treatment with lenalidomide and dexamethasone. Again, at the moment of first publication, the early treatment resulted also into a significant benefit in terms of overall survival, and this benefit has been also confirmed with a long-term follow-up, a median follow-up of 75 months. As you probably know, we did or we planned an early intervention in the experimental arm when patients receiving lenalidomide single agent as maintenance developed biochemical relapse, and we decided to add a very low dose dexamethasone, and the disease was stabilized again. What is the benefit we get with this preemptive strategy? You can see here as the median overall survival or the overall survival for those patients who had not relapsed is similar to those patients who biochemical relapse and received a very low dose dexamethasone. However, the survival is significantly poor for those patients who directly progressed to active disease. The rescue therapies our patients received were fine or were according to the age, and most patients received proteasome inhibitor, IMIDs, a combination of PIs and IMIDs, and even transplant if the patients were candidates to receive autologous stem cell transplantation. What about the use of continuous treatment with Lendex and the possibility of more resistant disease? Here you can see the overall survival from the moment of progression, and you can see as there are not any significant differences indicating that early treatment does not induce more resistant relapses. From the safety point of view, the treatment was generally very well tolerated with a few grade 3-4 adverse events. And so if we consider all these results, you can see probably the planned algorithm for the management of smoldering myeloma patients, an ultra-high-risk myeloma, low and intermediate, follow-up and for high risk. I think that the best way is to include these patients in clinical trials to have more and more knowledge about the biology of the disease. However, you know that there is not any approved drug for the treatment of high-risk smoldering myeloma patients, and what we are going to do now in Spain is to write guidelines, Spanish guidelines for the management of smoldering myeloma patients, because according to our results, we consider that our patients can probably benefit if they receive early treatment. What is the most appropriate treatment? We don't know. We know that Lymphoma resulted effective, and many trials are currently ongoing in high-risk smoldering myeloma patients with many different combinations. This is the combination we are using in our clinical trial in Spain for transplant candidate high-risk smoldering myeloma patients, including carfilzomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone transplant consolidation and maintenance. And our objective is not to delay the progression to myeloma, but to evaluate the proportion of patients who achieved sustained immunophenotypic complete response, and our hope is probably to cure some patients. I think that this is my final slide, and I would say that probably in the future what we have to do is to create new biomarkers. New biomarkers will be validated, and I would say that more smoldering myeloma patients will be considered as myeloma, and patients will be treated as patients with active disease. And finally, just thanks to the Spanish Myeloma Group and to all investigators, including patients in our trial. Thank you very much.